Hi, good morning. Thank you, first of all, very much for this invitation. I will try to talk a little bit more about concepts in general, and I only have a small teaser in there with regards to our data. So as we all know, we're all living longer today than ever before. A child born today can become 80 years. That's double from just a century ago. And it's really due to all the additional things that we know that we need to do, clean water, vaccines which are around, and medication. Now, living longer is not only good news. The truth is that by the age of 65, we start to suffer from age-related diseases. You've heard this before. And these age-related diseases are chronic diseases. This means immediately that they have a huge impact on the healthcare system. And probably worst of all is the impact it has on the social activities of the patient themselves, but also on its family. Now, imagine that you turn 65 and you know that you still have 2 decades of good health in front of you. And this will allow you to contribute to the social environment and the wealth of economy, because you will have the power to use all that information that you have gathered and the knowledge that you have collected throughout the years. This is, of course, our ultimate aim, but we have some challenges ahead of us. And as discussed already yesterday a lot, we have some challenges at the level of science. I'm not going to go into those. We do have some challenges on the regulatory perspective as well, because as already been mentioned before, there's not a condition called aging for which you can have a regulatory pathway. So it means that from a drug development perspective, there's no real easy way to understand what regulators expect from you to provide to them so that they can approve a condition. And I think this afternoon there will be more about that as well. So drug development, there are different ways to do drug development, and I will explain a couple of different concepts to you, and I think we will need all of them. I think in this new field of the biology of aging, there's not one good way, there's not a bad way, there are just different ways. Just like we're doing in the basic science, we're tackling it from different perspectives, we're doing the same thing here. So traditionally, if you do drug development, you start in the lab, you define the target which is important for your disease or the work that you're focusing on, you look for a compound that can interact with that specific target, you confirm in animal models that it works, you move to the clinic and do your clinical trials to make your compound ready to go to the market. That's one way of doing drug development. Another way of doing drug development is starting at the end. So you start by looking at compounds which are on the market. You try to figure out how they have an impact on the disease area that you're interested in and which targets that they can influence in that community. Then you do the same thing, you confirm in animal models and you go to the clinic. This has some advantages because, as already has been mentioned, it's really important if you go to a kind of healthy population that you don't have side effects. This allows you to take that into account. These products are on the market for a long time, so there is a lot of knowledge out there, a lot of publications that have been done in the past, from which you can gather information and do a kind of in silico assessment of the activity. And that is actually what we do at Rejuvenate Biomed. So at Rejuvenate Biomed, our long-term goal is to keep people healthy for life. As already has been mentioned before, we're not really interested in making people live longer, but really keeping that period that we are on this earth as enjoyable as possible. And we do that by repurposing. That's our strategy. What we do, we are a biotech company, and we will continue up to phase 2B, where we will show efficacy in humans. At that moment in time, the compounds will be transferred to another organization. Now, where did Rejuvenate come from all of a sudden? Well, it's a little bit inspired by my father. Quite some years ago, he started to suffer from age-related diseases. At that moment in time, I was working at J&J, and actually, I was in the prevention area on age-related diseases, but individual diseases. We started to figure out how we could help my father getting this cardiovascular disease stabilized. Very soon after that, he had Alzheimer, then Parkinson came in. In the meantime, he's sarcopenic and he's frail. So I was completely confused by this because I came from traditional drug pharma environment. We normally treat a disease and then you heal and that's about it. And here this did not seem to work. So I got interested in the biology of aging, and I was really amazed by all the work that had been done. So I asked my boss if I was allowed to look at how we were doing things within J&J from a prevention perspective, from a little bit of a different angle. He fortunately allowed me to do that, and that was the base for what is now the spin-out from J&J Rejuvenate Biomed. So we want to delay aging with existing medicines. So how did we now very concretely do that? We looked at more than 100 compounds which are currently on the market for more than 10 years. We assessed which ones would be good enough for a healthy population, because of course these products are being used in specific indications, and something that you tolerate as a side effect in oncology is not going to be the same thing that you would tolerate in this community. We also took into account if the compounds were oral versus IV, because we thought that if you want to go to this type of population, it should be something that, that is orally available. Once when we did that assessment, we had 14 safe products for this population. We saw that 7 did interfere with the aging pathways. We now were thinking about if we now could influence multiple targets at different levels, which were having the same mechanistic impact downstream, and if we could combine those and could have the synergistic approach, that would be something really interesting. So I was very happy with the presentations yesterday from Linda, which is really confirming that from a basic scientific perspective, this is absolutely making sense. So as I mentioned, we call our compound RGX01. We cannot reveal the name yet of the combination product in there, but that will be done very soon. And we know that we can influence multiple pathways. We also know, if we bring it back to the hallmarks of aging, that our main activities are in the mitochondrial dysfunction, nutrient sensing, and proteostasis. Now, we did not really take this as a selection criteria, but it's how it turns out. So again, taking a completely different approach is bringing you back to what we have learned yesterday from a scientific perspective. And that's what we like a lot about this reverse translation approach, which has been mentioned by Sarah this morning as well, because indeed, also there you can have real-world evidence to do some assessments. Another thing that was important for us in our selection criteria is if there was any reason to believe that these compounds could have the potential to influence multiple age-related diseases. And we did that by looking at multiple parameters in clinical studies that had been performed in the past. This was the in silico part. So now we had an idea on which compound, from a purely theoretical perspective, could have an impact on biology of aging. Then we were stuck, because how do you tackle that? As I mentioned, there's no regulatory path forward. It's very unclear how, from a clinical perspective, you have to move forward. So Dr. Sierra was so nice to talk to us, and that was, I think, end of 2016, to discuss one of the papers that had been published on how you potentially could go into that direction. And the idea was that you could tackle diseases in these type of elements: geriatric syndromes, age-related diseases, and resilience to acute stressors. So from that conversation, we took away the fact that we would need in the future to take little steps to get to the top of the mountain and really have a compound for which we can show that it can influence in general the biology of aging. So we decided if we can show for RGX01 that it is active in 2 what is in traditional pharma called independent age-related diseases, that would be a very good base for a later claim. In the hope, of course, that the lobbying organization by then would be ready and FDA and EMA would accept a condition called aging for a regulatory path. In that aspect, we took into account the learnings from this. We took into account the knowledge that we had from our compounds, and we decided to go for a musculoskeletal disease called sarcopenia. The reason why we thought sarcopenia is really an interesting disease to move into the field is because of the risk of physical disability, which is there. They have a poor quality of life, and there is an association with death. The other thing is that a lot of people are still very much under the impression that you need to be 80 or older to get sarcopenia. That's absolutely not the case. It's very clear that from the age of 60 onwards, you already see a lot of sarcopenia coming up. For us, this made it a little bit easier from a pharmaceutical perspective because, as you might know, just like you guys are depending on funding, we are depending on funding as well. So we need to convince the capital investment world that they provide investments in us. They do not want to invest in a company that is developing a compound for a disease which not is a disease or a condition which is not targetable from a regulatory perspective. So sarcopenia also solved that problem. Within sarcopenia, in the meantime, it's a recognized disease, there are international diagnostic criteria, and there are approved endpoints. What we do see from a global perspective, that sarcopenia in Europe is a little bit more accepted, and that aging in the US is a little bit more accepted. So we have to somehow find a way to bridge these two worlds so that we can be an added value to this community. This being said, up till now we had a lot of paperwork done, and now the truth had to be shown in our animal models. And I will just give you a small teaser on that one. Two of the animal models that we're using are C. elegans and mice. So in C. elegans, we looked at an increase in lifespan, but we were mainly interested, let me see if I can find the pointer. No, yeah, here it is. In a shift in this direction. So this lower part is not that much of an interest to us. We want to get more of these worms which are behaving more healthy for a longer period of time. The other thing that we did is look at the worms and figure out how they were moving. And we, just for the sake of fun, made a translation to how fast they are moving. So the control worms are moving at a speed of 0.2 meters per hour. Not bad. But we have now speedy worms. After our treatment, they were moving at a speed of 0.48 meters per hour. Now, the speed itself is, of course, not that important. We have many more parameters behind it. We also see that they can move in a directional way. They're not just laying there and spastically moving. We're doing bands, calculations, and many more assessments. We're looking at muscle, etc. In mice, we now wanted to know, can we translate what we would like to see in humans, that they are functioning better? Is there a way for us to figure out how that's happening in mice? Just to get that first feel, we did not want to go for the traditional aging mice, but we wanted to have a first assessment of the activity. So we moved to the muscle-specific inducible OPA1 knockout mice. As you know, they're mitochondrial dysfunctional. What we saw is that if we did not treat them, and we put them at 90 days on a walk, a treadmill, then we saw that they were moving at a traditional speed, which is normal for that age, for that knockout mouse. If we now treated them with RGX-01, the impact was phenomenal. We had hoped to see an improvement, but did not guess that we would see such a nice improvement. Now, endurance is, of course, linked to more other things than pure muscle, which is for us, from the aging perspective, very important. And for the sarcopenia, we can pull some information out of it. Then from a strength perspective, grip strength, when we looked at that, we saw something very similar, that after treatment, the knockout mice could have a stronger grip strength as well. If we now look at the mice from a more muscle-specific element, we saw that the muscles were smaller in these knockout mice and the strength was reduced. Nevertheless, we saw an improvement with RGX-01. But what was more interesting was when we started to correct for the mass of the muscle, we saw that we were even getting them back to wild-type mice, which is very unusual in this type of setting. This was for us enough to move forward and to convince people to get additional funding. This created for us the possibility to do the real stuff. And we are extremely honored to work with Rafa de Cabo, and where we will perform in his lab what we call now the SLAM 2, because he has, of course, the SLAM study. So the study for longevity of aging mice, a study which is going over a really long period from an age of 13 months onwards up till the end of their lifespan, looking at many, many different parameters. We were able to bring that in, because we are looking at sarcopenia, which is later said on, and looking at the muscle. But this is giving us a lot of additional information on the whole aging concept. So this way, we within the company always try to focus on the sarcopenia, but add in all the elements that we need from the biology of aging perspective. So as I mentioned, this is what we do, repurposing. Drug repurposing has some pros and cons. One of the elements, which is the elephant in the room always, is IP. If you cannot have IP on a combination or on a product, there's not one investor in the whole world who's going to be interested to put the money in your company. So the way we do the selection of the compounds is also related to that. So of course, we look at freedom to operate. We look if there is something really specific new to the combination, which allows you to have the patentability available. And that's what we did for this compound as well. So now, we want to go now to the clinic. As I mentioned, we'll do it stepwise. First indication will be sarcopenia for our product. In here, again, the cutoff points have been established. We know what we need to measure from a sarcopenia perspective. Within this study, again, we will be adding in a lot of parameters that have been discussed in the last couple of days, looking at chronological age. Inflammation has been mentioned already before as well. That way, we can gather a lot of information that can help us in two directions. So just to wrap up, sarcopenia, we wanted to have a disease that did not only have one problem in one organ, but from which we saw that it really had an impact on this quality of life. The only thing I can still do is thank the team, which is in our company in the meantime. We're still a pretty young company, but I especially would like to thank all our collaborators. Because it's because of all of you here, which have gathered all this knowledge already for such a long time, that we can now try you to help to make the translation to the clinic. And that's really our goal. We know that there's not one good way to do it. We all have to come together and share the information. And I'm very pleased to feel the dynamics in this community to do this. So thank you very much. Yeah.